O God, from the rising of the sun to its setting, your name is worthy of all praise. Let our prayer rise before you as incense, and with the lifting up of our hands, may we offer our whole lives to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I invite you to stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Holy Gospel is according to St. Mark, the 5th chapter. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from a hemorrhage for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had. And she was no better, but rather she grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I will touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it, but the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except for Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha cum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this they were overcome with amazement, and he strictly ordered them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace and peace to you. Amen. Well, there's a lot happening in this gospel text in a very short period of time. Lucky us, not only do we have one healing today, we have two. What's even more interesting is that these healings take place within each other's stories. Jesus is on the way to heal Jairus' daughter when a woman is healed amongst the crowd. And it seems that nothing ordinary happens when Jesus is around. There is always something happening. Perhaps this is what drew people to him. Perhaps it's why there always seemed to be a crowd wherever he went. Jesus is always doing something, and that something is always miraculous. So tell me if this sounds familiar. The alarm goes off, you wake up at your specific time, it's time to get ready for the day, you brush your teeth, you take a shower, you get dressed, comb your hair, you get get ready for work. You have some breakfast, you head to work, you work, and there's lunchtime. Love lunchtime. You go back to work, then it's the end of the work day. Hallelujah. It's the end of the work day, right? You come home, you make dinner, you have some kind of evening activity, you go to sports, you go to concerts, you read, you watch TV, and then you go to bed. And the next day, same thing, repeat. More or less, would you say that this is a pretty accurate description of how most people's days tend to go? Does this sound familiar to anyone? Okay. It would seem that we have a God who only works in the extremes. At least that's how it might appear to us. You see, we tend to notice God the most when we're in the extremes of life, when we're on those high mountaintops or those low valleys. Those are the times when we really begin to notice God in our lives. The daily routine, maybe not so much. I think that we do indeed see God in those extremes, but I wonder if we could still see God during the times when life doesn't seem to be so extreme. I wonder if we could notice God in the everyday, the normal, or even the mundane everyday tasks that we do. I think it's easier to find God in those joyous moments or in those low valleys. But we tend to notice God in the extremes rather than the normal or the routine. Of course, we can't live our lives completely on the extremes. That would get exhausting. But yet, it seems all you have to do is turn on the news to know that our culture gravitates towards the extremes. You see, and I think this is because we like things to be certain. We like to know what to expect, and the extremes are really the ends that we know what to expect. We like to live our lives black and white. We don't really like to find ourselves in the gray area in the middle. The extremes bring certainty, things being more clear-cut for us. There's little surprise in the extremes. But I have some bad news. I hope this doesn't come as surprising to anybody, but life is not black and white. Life is not certain. Things don't always go as planned. I'm sure you all know this. In fact, I would say that we live most of our lives in the gray areas. And I'm not so sure that's a bad thing. But the difficulty with living in the gray area is that we may not know exactly which shade of gray we are. I'm told there are 50, but I think there are more. We live our lives in the gray, the normal, the mundane, the average, the uneventful, the same routine over and over. Where is God in those moments? Where is God when our faith isn't on the mountaintop or isn't in the low valley? Where is God when we're living in the gray? Perhaps this is part of the problem, though. Perhaps we become so accustomed to the way things are that we no longer see the miracle of each moment. We've confined ourselves to the gray area, and in the process, maybe we've confined God. We've confined God to a place where miracles only happen in the most extreme circumstances. Life itself, each day, each breath, is no longer seen as a miracle to us. It's something that happens every day. easy to take life for granted. And I think that oftentimes we fly past each day looking forward to the next one, looking forward to that next weekend, to that next vacation, or even to that next year. We're not content with living in the miracle of today because we've painted it gray, made it normal, average, uninteresting. So here we have in our gospel text two women. One is a 12-year-old daughter of a prominent leader in the synagogue, and the other is an unnamed woman, someone who has been experiencing 12 years of illness and disease. And these women are reminded of the miracle of every day because of their encounter with Jesus. You see, we remember that when Jesus is present, when God is present, something happens, and not just something, not just the same things that happen every day, something miraculous happens. Things are no longer ordinary when God is around. But doesn't that mean that all of life, each moment of each day, is miraculous in and of itself? If we truly believe that God is present right here and right now, wouldn't that mean that each moment is a miraculous event in and of itself? If God is present right here, right now, this shouldn't feel like just another worship service. Same old, same old. This shouldn't be a gray area. This shouldn't be normal or average or mundane. And I would suggest that it isn't any of those things in reality. It's we who in our minds have turned it into gray, normal, same old, same old. The fact that we are able to gather together is a miracle. The fact that we are able to gather together to praise God is a miracle. The fact that we are able to gather together to praise and pray for one another is a miracle. God is certainly here. God is certainly active right now because wherever God goes, things happen, but not ordinary things. Miraculous things happen where God is present, and God is always present. You see, in this place, in every place, God is present. And because God is present, miracles happen. Miracles happen because grace happens. Where God is present, there is grace. There is life. And that is a miracle. Grace happens. Grace happens whether we realize it or not. Grace happens even when we find ourselves stuck in the routines of our lives. Grace happens because it's not dependent on how we feel or how we see the world. Grace happens because of the one who gives it. Grace happens because God desires something more than just ordinary and gray. Grace happens because each day is special. Each day, each moment is a miracle. May this grace allow us to see the ways in which each moment in life is that, just that, nothing short of a miracle. Amen.